highest mountain. Looked all around, couldn't find nobody. Went down into the deepest valley. Looked all around, down there, couldn't find nobody. Went across the deep blue sea, couldn't find one to compare to your grace, your love, your mercy. Nobody greater, nobody greater than you. Searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater, nobody greater, no, nobody greater than you. I searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater, nobody greater, nobody greater than you. Nobody can heal like you can. Oh, most holy one, you are the great I am. Awesome in all your ways, and mighty is your hand. You are he who carried out redemption's plan. You are he who carried out redemption's plan.
Search all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody.
Nobody great. Body greater, Jesus.
Nobody greater than you.
Searched all over.
Searched all over.
Couldn't find no.
Couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low.
Body great, body great,
nobody greater than you.
Come on, lift those hands for real in here. Come on. Nobody greater,
nobody greater,
Jesus.
Nobody greater than you.
greater. Nobody greater. Nobody greater. No.
Nobody greater than you.
Now lift those hands, singers, and let's just give him the glory. Nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Couldn't find nobody.
Nobody.
You lift your hand and say that with us tonight. Come on, nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater than you.
Nobody greater than you.
Nobody like you, Jesus. Nobody greater than you, God.
Nobody greater.
Oh.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater than you.
Everyone in the building, just sing that tonight. That's what we came to say. Nobody greater.
Nobody great.
No matter where you look or where you
nobody
go.
Nobody great.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater than you.
Angels bow before you. Heaven and earth adore you. Nobody.
Nobody great.
We came to lift you up.
Nobody great.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater than you.
Come on, everyone in the building singing. Nobody greater.
Nobody great. Say, yeah. You did not create me to worry.
create me to worry. You did not create me to fear, but you created me to worship daily. So I'ma leave it all right here.
Trust
in.
Pastor.
Good morning, Clive. How are you today?
I'm doing well. How about you?
I am pretty good, thanks. Glad you're to be here.
You ready to praise the Lord?
Amen.
All right. Here we go. Bless me, bless me, oh Lord, bless me indeed in lot, my territory, oh Lord, bless me. I pray for increase. I pray for increase. 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 Oh, Lord, bless me indeed in large my territory. Oh Lord, bless me indeed. I pray for increase. Keep your hands upon me so that evil cannot harm me. Sunshine and rain, sickness and pain, God, I come to you. In large territory, in large territory. Oh Lord, bless me indeed. I pray for increase. I pray for increase. Keep your hand upon me. Bless me, bless me, oh Lord, bless me indeed, enlarge my territory, oh Lord, bless me. I pray for increase. I pray for increase. This is my prayer. I pray for increase.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And amen. Thank you so much, Clive.
You're welcome.
Good morning, beloved of Good Shepherd, and any visitors who may be with us this morning. Thank you so much for being here with us for worship. As always, it is my prayer and my hope that the time that we spend together today will give you sustenance for your journey, that something that is sung, something that is said, something that is read will strengthen you and keep you as you journey through this next week and beyond. We know that these are times that are unsettling at best, but God is with us. And for that, we are very, very thankful. So let's take a moment to gather ourselves and center ourselves as we prepare to enter this worship space together. We will hear today in our first reading about God, how God invites all who are hungry, all who are thirsty, to receive food and drink without any cost whatsoever. And then in our gospel reading, we will hear about how Jesus feeds the hungry multitude and reveals the abundance of God. At our Eucharistic table, we remember all who are hungry and all who are poor, economically poor, spiritually poor in our world today. And as we share the bread of life, we are sent forth to give of ourselves, to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry. Our worship will begin with our call to worship. Come, Holy Spirit, ignite our hearts with joy and confidence. For God has done wondrous things for us. Come, Holy Spirit, fill us with the power of the rushing wind that we may faithfully serve you in all that we do. For Christ has called each of us and blessed us. Come, Holy Spirit, be with us today. Help us to boldly proclaim Christ risen. And God's people said, amen. Our worship will continue with our order for confession and forgiveness. Lord God, you know us too well. You know that we would be like the disciples following the crucifixion and even after the resurrection. We would rather hide and mutter and weep than proclaim the power of your love. Redeeming God, the world is a difficult place. We confess that we fear so much. We want people to like us, And so we hold back our proclamation of faith. We don't want to offend anyone. But your love and your presence are not offensive. They are empowering and healing. Bring your holy fire upon us this day and ignite a spark of joy in our hearts and our voices. Bring the power of your rushing wind through our spirits that we may be turned in new directions for service and witness. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Beloved of God, God's awesome love is offered to you. Even when you fear or are unsure of your faith, know that God is with you. Be not afraid. Be not afraid. Hallelujah. For hope does not disappoint, but God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen and hallelujah.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Glorious God, your generosity waters the world with goodness, and you cover creation with abundance. Awaken in us a hunger for the food that satisfies both body and spirit. And with this food, fill all the starving world. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, Good Shepherd family, and welcome to the ninth Sunday after Pentecost. We've gathered to praise the Lord, we've gathered to glorify him. And so together as one, I welcome you and anyone who may be visiting with us this morning. Praise the Lord. Good Shepherd family, it is with great sadness and thanksgiving that we announce the death of Walter Winfrey, our dear sister Ruth's husband. We celebrate his life and we rejoice that he has claimed his resurrection promise. As we always do in the Good Shepherd family, please hold Ruth and her sons and all who loved and cared for Walter in prayer as they go through this time of transition and mourning. Today, at 1:30, immediately after service, we will do a Sunday school drive-by in the church parking lot. And the drive-by commences the 5 weeks of virtual Bible study that we will be having for our Sunday school children. So next week and the following week, immediately after service, virtual Bible study will be held with our faithful leaders, Joy and Ashley. So if you have any children at home, nieces, nephews, cousins, or anyone who may be interested, virtual Bible study is open to them too. So please invite anyone that you know who might be interested in joining our Sunday school children. The prayer shawl ministry will soon begin. If you are interested in joining the prayer shawl ministry, there are no requirements for previous skills at knitting or crocheting. Please contact Pastor if you're interested. If you can, and you're interested, or if you want to learn or you're interested, no one will be turned away. And last but not least, we're still seeking a few members of our congregation who are willing to serve on the team that will help to strategize, plan, and lead the re-entry into our building. Please contact Pastor if you're interested. It would be a great opportunity to participate in the process. You would have a say-so, you would have a better understanding. It would take away some of the mystery because Pastor Linda is ready, willing, and able to guide us through the process. But we need to be able to gather a team together to work on this. So if you're interested, contact Pastor Manson, and she will definitely gather us together and lead us in the right direction. That concludes the announcements this morning. Thank you so much.
Amen. Our worship will continue as we hear the word that's spoken through scripture. We will begin with the blessing of our lector for today. Let us pray. Everlasting God, when he read in the synagogue at Nazareth, Jesus proclaimed the good news of salvation for which he would give up his life. Bless Carol as she proclaims your words of life. Strengthen her faith that she may read with conviction and boldness. And may we all put into practice what is read. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Good morning, Good Shepherd. The first lesson is a reading from Isaiah 55, 1 through 5. God invites Israel to a great feast at which both food and drink are free. God also promises to make an everlasting covenant with all peoples, with promises that previously had been limited to Israel. As David was a witness to the nations, these nations shall now acknowledge the ways in which God has glorified Israel. The reading. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you that have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread? And your labor for that which does not satisfy. Listen carefully to me and eat what is good and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and a commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The next reading is from Psalm 145. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Lord, you are good to all, and your compassion is over all your works. The Lord upholds all those who fall and lifts up those who are bowed down. The eyes of all wait upon you, O Lord, and you give them their food in due season. You open wide your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. You are righteous in all your ways and loving in all your works. You are near to all who call upon you, to all who call upon you faithfully. You fulfill the desire of those who fear you. You hear their cry and save them. You watch over all those who love you, but all the wicked you shall destroy. My mouth shall speak the praise of the Lord. Let all flesh bless God's holy name forever and ever. Amen.
The second lesson is a reading from Romans chapter 9, verses 1 through 5. This begins a new section of Paul in Paul's letter in which he will deal with the place of Israel in God's saving plan. He opens by highlighting how Israel's heritage and legacy include being God's children, having God's covenants, being given God's love, participating in worship of God, and receiving divine promises. The reading. I am speaking the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it by the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my own people, my kindred according to the flesh. They are Israelites, and to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. To them belong the patriarchs, and from them, according to the flesh, comes the Messiah, who is over all. God bless it forever. Amen. Word of God, word of life.
Pastor, you're on mute.
I invite you to listen to the Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 14th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now, when Jesus heard about the beheading of John the Baptist, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd. And he had compassion. Excuse me. He saw a great crowd and had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing but 5 loaves and 2 fish." And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds, and all ate and were filled. And they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. This, beloved, is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Thank you so much, Dana and Clive. So let me stop sharing for. So this is one of those weeks that it's really hard to figure out what to talk about. That story from Matthew, Jesus feeding the 5,000 men plus women and children, that's a part that we often miss. There were 5,000 men plus women and children. How many were there who were fed? That's one of my favorite stories. But I found that this week I didn't have anything new to say about that text. I don't often go back and look at my previous sermons, but as I wrote my sermon for this week, it felt the same. It felt like something I had said before. And so I looked back at what I preached to you last year, and what I was going to say was almost the same thing. So as I prayed and I meditated, I realized there was a text for us this week that we don't often hear. It's a text that's not in our lectionary, but it's in the alternate lectionary. It's a text from Genesis. So I'm going to go off lectionary this week and use the alternate Old Testament text, because this is a text that really captivates me, and I think it really speaks to my life, and my prayer is that it also speaks to you. So I'm going to read only a portion of it because the text is kind of long. The text is Genesis chapter 32, verses 3 through 31, but I'm only going to read to you verses 22 through 31. The same night he got up and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone. A man wrestled with him until daybreak. And when the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go until you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, Jacob. Then the man said, you shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed. Then Jacob asked him, please tell me your name. But he said, why is it that you ask my name? And there he blessed him. So Jacob called that place Peniel, saying, for I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved. The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. May the word of God be blessed. So this story of Jacob's epic wrestling match near the river Jabbok, this story really kind of shapes my view in ways that I don't always expect. And I'm sure in ways that you don't expect, but I've decided I'm going to share some of that with you this morning. You see, Jacob is returning to the place of his birth after being away for 20 years. He will be seeing his brother Esau for the first time in a very long time. The brother whose life was turned upside down by Jacob's deceit. Jacob has no idea how Esau will receive him, but he's probably very afraid. He has already sent his possessions ahead of himself. He sent his wife, he sent his concubines, he sent his children across the Jabbok River. He sent, and then Jacob decides that he's going to spend the night alone. The scripture doesn't tell us why Jacob decided that, but you know, I like to use my holy imagination. And so I think that maybe Jacob wants to pray and beg God for the courage to face his brother. Or maybe he's filled with anxiety because of how he left things with Esau. Or maybe he's just a coward and he sent his family ahead hoping that they would soften Esau up before he gets there. We don't know why, because scripture doesn't tell us. All we know from scripture is that Jacob is alone and he's probably very vulnerable in ways that he hasn't been for a very long time. And everything that might protect him, all of his wealth, all of his servants, his large family, they're all gone. And he's there next to that river alone. And then a nameless, faceless stranger comes out of nowhere and wrestles him to the ground. So let me ask you, how often have you found yourself alone in a dark and desolate place? How long or how often have you been in battle with something that you don't recognize? Something that just might be God, but you don't recognize that until much later. And if you're like me, it's been too many times to count. Scholars have debated about this text for many years, and I really like reading the lectionary, the commentaries about it, because they argue about what's really happening here. What's really going on in this Jacob story? Is he attacked by robbers? Does he have a panic attack? Is that faceless and nameless stranger really his brother Esau in disguise? Well, all the commentaries don't matter to me, not in this particular instance, because it doesn't matter to me, because I feel like all of the epic battles of my life and maybe of your life are battles with guilt or shame or fear or doubt or grief or unforgiveness. Our wrestling matches with our families and our friends, with our enemies, in our community, in our church, because of our creed. I've come to understand that those wrestling matches, those battles ultimately are with God or about God. It's with God in a relationship to God and in God's all-encompassing presence that we fight those battles that bend us, those battles that break us, and those battles that remake us. It is in God's company that we face the demons that are within us and the demons that are around us. It is God alone who brings us to the very edges of our own strength so that finally, finally, we will surrender. And by doing so, by surrendering, we allow ourselves to be saved. Whether we recognize the stranger as God or not, beloved, I believe that God is always the one that we are in a struggle with. God is always the one who battles with us and against us, not for our detriment or harm, but for our transformation. Now, the text tells us that Jacob and the man wrestle all night long. They wrestle until Jacob, I believe, is sure that he's going to win. They wrestle until they see the dawn. And the story speaks to me here in a very powerful way because I believe that I first heard this story when I was a kid in Sunday school, and it absolutely terrified me. God in the guise of an angel or a man or a demon, and then he dislocates Jacob's hip and then just leaves him there by the river. What kind of God is that? What kind of God would do such a thing? Wasn't God supposed to be loving and protective and safe? Well, obviously not. And believe me, God is not, at least not in the ways that I would define loving and safe and protective. The God who goes toe-to-toe with Jacob is not a God whose first priority is our comfort and ease. This is not a God who makes nice just to keep us happy. No, Jacob's God is unpredictable, Jacob's God is strange, and Jacob's God does not hesitate to wrestle in the mud for a few hours to bring Jacob to his knees. You see, beloved, because our God is a God of dust and sweat and tears and blood. Our God is a God willing to become dirty to lift us out of the dirt. Our God is one who wants to engage, a God that we can throw ourselves against with the full weight of all of our thoughts and all of our questions and all of our ideas and all of our feelings, a God who invites our consistency, our persistence, our intensity, and our strength. Our God is a God who does not let go. So back to the story. The night wears on and the stranger sees that Jacob has no intention of giving up. So he strikes Jacob on the hip socket, dislocating his hip and causing him to limp. Now you've heard me before talk about Frederick Buechner. He's one of my favorite theologians. And in his sermon called The Magnificent Defeat, which is about this particular text, Frederick Buechner says, all the night through, they struggle in silence until just before morning, when it looks as though a miracle might happen. Jacob is winning. The stranger cries out to be set free before the sun rises, and then suddenly everything is reversed. He merely touches the hollow of Jacob's thigh, and in a moment, Jacob is lying crippled and helpless. The sense we have, which Jacob must have had, that the whole battle was from the beginning fated to end this way, that the stranger had simply held back until now, letting Jacob exert all his strength and almost win so that when he was defeated, he would know that he was truly defeated. So that he would know that not all of the shrewdness, will, brute force, all that he could muster were not enough to get him the victory. Jacob will not release his grip though. Only now it is a grip of violent, of not of violence, but of need. The grip of a drowning man. Beloved, we live in a culture that celebrates success and mocks defeat. But sometimes I believe that defeat is mercy. Sometimes defeat is exactly the thing that saves us. What I take away from this story is a paradoxical truth. The truth that blessing and bruising are not mutually exclusive in the realm of God. We can limp and prevail at the same time. We can experience healing in our brokenness. And if we want to engage with God, then we must expect that we are going to be changed in the process. And not always in ways that are painless or comfortable or easy. Now, I can't dictate the terms of whatever blessing God may send my way. I can't say, God, I want to be blessed, but I don't want to limp. Because sometimes, beloved, the blessing is the limp. So back to the story. As dawn breaks, the stranger asks Jacob to let him go, to disengage. And Jacob is steadfast. He says, no, I will not let you go until you bless me. And I love that line. I absolutely love it because it assures me that sometimes winning involves nothing that's more sophisticated than just not giving up. Sometimes the spiritual life is about nothing more than just hanging on for dear life to a God who feels mysterious to us or nameless or bewildering or maybe even frightening. Sometimes this whole following Christ thing, sometimes it just comes down to saying, there is so much that I can't wrap my head around, but I know that there's a blessing in this mess somewhere, and I'm just going to hang on. I'm going to hang on until I find it. So Jacob hangs on. Jacob hangs on waiting for something good to happen, and the stranger consents to his request for a blessing. But first he asked Jacob a terrible, terrible question, but a very essential one. What is your name? Now, why is this question so terrible, Pastor? Well, if you don't know this whole story, and I'm not going to recount it for you now, but consider the last time that Jacob was asked this question. The last time he was asked this question, he was 20 years younger. And he was standing in his disabled father's tent. He was wearing his brother's clothes. Isaac, his father, was very suspicious. He sensed something. But Isaac also knew the immense power of blessing, and he didn't want to squander it on the wrong person. So he asked once again, who is standing in this tent? And Jacob, this trickster, Jacob, this manipulator, Jacob, this deceitful one, Jacob, this selfish one, his very name meant heel grabber, which meant the one who impedes progress. This Jacob looks into his father's eyes and he says, I am Esau, your firstborn son. So now here he is 20 years later and he gets a do-over. The stranger asked him, what is your name? What's your identity? Who are you? Now, I wonder if this is a question that God asks us to. Is this a question that God asks us every time we wrestle with God? Not because God doesn't know who we are, but because so very often we don't know who we are. Or even if we do, we don't want to face what we know. So what's your name? Who are you? Who are you really at the center of your being, at your core? I can tell you what Jacob learns that night by the river is that big, terrible, life-changing questions, those questions that we evade, those questions that we ignore, they return to us again and again and again until we find the courage to look them in the eye and answer them honestly. I'm quite sure if Jacob had lied to that stranger, that battle would have continued. continue for who knows how long, God would have challenged Jacob's destructive self-deceptions over and over and over again until he finally surrendered to the uncomfortable truth and said, I am Jacob. I am Jacob the heel grabber. I am Jacob the deceiver. I am Jacob the schemer. I am Jacob the man who lied to my father and cheated my brother. I manipulated my father-in-law. I abandoned every disaster I created. I am Jacob. You see, beloved, I believe that it's only when we name the worst, only when we name the worst, do we release it from having power over us. It's only when we confess our ugliness, the ugliness that is within us, the ugliness that's around us, that God can begin that holy work of transformation within us. The stranger says, you shall no longer be called Jacob. You shall be called Israel. For you have striven with God and with humans, and you have prevailed. Now, I don't know about you, but this moment in the story kind of makes me cringe and laugh at the same time. Because truly, I have fought with you all night long, and the blessing that you're giving me is that you're changing my name. This new name, Israel, it kind of guarantees Jacob that he's going to have a holy struggle for the rest of his life. You shall be called Israel. You shall spend the rest of your life limping and wrestling with God, battling with God, contending with God. But the good news is you can say goodbye to the strict trickster, Jacob. You can say goodbye, but now you are a wrestler. And so I say, if that was Jacob's blessing, then maybe it's really not as bad as it sounds on the surface. Because I believe that wrestling, as it turns out, wrestling is not an irreverent thing. Because wrestling is the opposite of apathy. Wrestling is the opposite of resignation, and it's the opposite of quitting. It's the opposite of complacency. And maybe even it's the opposite of loneliness. To fight, to wrestle is to stay close to your opponent, to wrap your arms around them. Fighting means that we haven't walked away. We haven't walked away from God. And beloved, God certainly has not walked away from us. So this is both a challenge and an invitation. To those of us who think that our relationship with God has to be smooth and a easy ride most of the time. And I'm talking about this now because we've been talking about discipleship on Wednesday nights a lot. And I think a lot of times we think that if we are walking right and trying to live right, then things are supposed to go right. But the God of Jacob delights in those who strive with him, those who struggle with him. The opposite of loving God is not fighting God. The opposite of loving God is not caring enough to fight. So don't worry if you're wrestling. Wrestling is our best protection against spiritual apathy. Wrestling is what keeps God relevant in our lives. It keeps God personal. It continues to keep God as a force for us to reckon with rather than just a dusty relic that we put up on the shelf and forget it's there. Now, I can only speak for myself. I can't speak for you, but in my human relationships, I don't bother getting worked up about something that I don't care about. I don't bother to fight with people who I'm not passionate about. So to wrestle with God is to insist that God matters. As this story continues and what we heard today kind of comes to an end, the sun comes up and it becomes Jacob's turn to rename the place where he was wounded. And he calls that muddy wrestling ring Peniel, saying, I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved. From this very detail, I understand that it's important to remember and to name the places where God shows up and where God contends with us. These peniels where God meets us in our very darkness, these places where we lose ourselves and find our true names, these places where mystery wrestles us towards salvation, these places where we exhaust our own strength and finally collapse into the strength of God. Beloved, these are the holiest of places. These places leave us blessed. They leave us limping all at the same time. So beloved, today I say to you, may we brave these places over and over and over again, because God is in them. God is in those places, always ready to meet us, always ready to wrestle with us. And when we're in these places and we're wrestling, I pray that we will prevail over them each time. Every time that night fades and the sun begins to rise, I pray that we will prevail. And may our aches and our pains and our bruises, may all of those things be the testaments of our joy. Amen. So sorry.
If it
And that was worth hearing twice.
Amen.
Amen. Our worship will continue as we profess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Good morning.
Good morning.
With the prayers of intercession, and our response this morning is, hear our cry and save us. Excuse me. Confident of God's care for us in the midst of the world's sufferings, we join together from our separate spaces in the power of the Spirit to pray for the church, the earth, the world, and all who are in need. Respond to each petition with the words, hear our cry and save us. God of abundance, you take resources that appear to be meager. Bless them, and there is enough, that there is enough. May your church trust that what you bless and ask us to share with the world is abundantly sufficient. Give to our bishops, pastors, deacons, and congregational leaders wisdom for their tasks in this challenging time. Lord, you are good to all.
Hear our cry and save us.
Save us. God of the earth, your bountiful creation offers sustenance and life for all creatures. Protect this abundance for the well-being of all. Replenish groundwater supplies, provide needed rains in places of drought, and protect forests from wildfires. Lord, you are good to all.
Hear our cry and save us.
O God, sovereign of the world, we pray that the leaders of all nations strive for justice for all. Guide our government in all of its dealings with. Bring an end to racism in our society. Lead and guide our elected officials to govern with integrity. Lord, you are good to all.
Hear our cry and save us.
O God, storehouse of goodness, visit all who face the coronavirus, especially those who are incarcerated. Give us, O Lord of life, a vaccine. Assist all who face eviction from their residence. Bring wholeness and healing to those who suffer in body or spirit, especially those that we name on our prayer list this morning. We pray healing for Ruth, for Shaniqua, for Janice, for Etta, for Dorette, for Tony, for Deirdre, for Matthew, for Dennis, for Rich, for Jody, for Ahmed, for Sean, for Stefan, for Leslie, for Selwyn, for Rick, the Foster family, for Beverly, for Alexis, for Elder Barrow, for Shakira, for Jordan, for Joan, for Zanitha, for Clement, for Bernice, Bruce, and Etta, and Rita, I'm sorry, for Paul, for Vera, for John, for Nora, for Cecil, for Wade, for Karen, for Christina, for Emmy, for Francina, for Thelma, for Ernestine, for Glenwood, for Rashawn, and for Zeta. Excuse me. Lord, you are good to all.
Hear our cry and save us.
O God, giver of bread, teach us how to feed the hungry, the families and individuals who cannot afford groceries, the homeless on our streets, the farmers devastated by pestilence. Give to all creatures their food in due season. Lord, you are good to all.
Hear our cry and save us.
You offer freely the fullness of salvation. Give our congregation, Good Shepherd, such a welcoming heart that our words and actions may extend your free and abundant hospitality to all whom we encounter. Lord, you are good to all.
Hear our cry and save us.
You gather your saints as one, united in the body of Jesus. Bring us with all your saints to the heavenly banquet. We remember with love and thanksgiving the saints we have known, especially Walter Winfrey and those named before you now. Lord, you are good to all.
Hear our cry and save us.
In the certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
God feeds us with the presence of Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, we ask that you present your tithes and your offering either by holding up your phones or your check or your envelopes at this time as we thank God for his provision. Let us pray together on mute. God of goodness and growth,
all creation is yours. And your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. Water and word, wine and bread.
These
are signs of your abundant grace. Nourish us through these gifts that we might proclaim your steadfast love in our communities and in the world through Jesus Christ, our strength and our song. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safe through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ and praise to you for the Spirit poured out on all nations. In the night in which our Jesus was to be betrayed, our Lord took bread. He gave thanks for it. He broke it, and he gave it to each of his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Each time you eat of this bread, do this for remembrance of me." And then, as was the custom, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks for it. He blessed it. And then he gave it to all present for them to drink, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. As often as you drink from this cup and eat of this bread, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again." So as we are gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. My brothers and sisters, let us take now together. This is the body of Christ broken for you. And this is the blood of Christ shed for you. Beloved of God, may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen.
Let us pray. God of the welcome table, in this meal we have feasted on your goodness and have been united by your presence among us. Empower us to go forth sustained by these gifts, so that we may share your neighborly love with all. Through Jesus Christ, the giver of abundant life. Amen.
Amen. Beloved of God, God blesses us and sends us out into the world in mission to the world. People of God, go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak and help the suffering. Honor all people. And love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Receive the blessing and the benediction. Neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything in all of creation, none of those things will ever be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. God, the Creator, Jesus, the Christ, and the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, may they bless you and keep you in eternal love. Amen.
Go in peace. Christ is with you.
Thanks be to God. And alleluia. Amen, and thank you so much, Clive.
You're welcome, Pastor.
Beloved of Good Shepherd, have a wonderful week. Take care of yourselves, stay safe, and we'll meet again next Sunday.
You too, Pastor.
Thank you, Pastor.
Have a blessed week.
Everyone have a blessed week.
Amen. Hi, Grandma.
Hi, Christina.
Wow. How are you doing, Grandma?
Hi.
Be well. Okay, everybody.
Good morning,
be
you
well.
Guys. All be safe in the hurricane coming.
Thank you, too.
Yeah, thank you. Yes. You too, Katina.
Good luck with
you're,
Bible
you're,
study.
How are things in your neck of the woods in Florida?
Good.
Well, right, we're preparing for it, but it's raining here already. But you not the winds, it's just raining.
Be safe,
yes.
Be safe.
I'll be home safe. Next Saturday. Saturday, okay. I'll be back in New York.
Okay.
We got our candles and we got our flashlights and we're good. Yes.
Good.
Be safe. Travel safe. Get here safe.
Thank you so much. Bye, baby.
Bye, Genevieve.
Genevieve. Hi, Genevieve.
Where's Genevieve?
Hi, Mother Shepherd. You're looking good.
Hi, Genevieve. Hi, baby girl.
We're going to Grandma's house.
You are?
Oh.
Very good.
Hi, baby. Wow.
Have fun.
You have a good day.
Shepherd.
Hi, Grandma. Oh, look at you.
I see Mrs. Clendenin. Good morning, Mrs. Clendenin.
Oh.
Miss Clendenin, you're not on the mic. We don't see you. We don't hear you.
Hi, Miss Shepherd.
Hurry home, Chiquita. Hurry back. Have a good morning. The storm.
Okay, now we hear you. Okay.
Have a great
night, right, everybody. Be well.
Thank you, Clive.
You're welcome.
Oh, yes, Clive and Jane, very nice singing. I enjoyed the songs.
Thank you.
The music that you guys are picking out of going with the sermon, like right on time. I tell you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The Holy Spirit is always moving, Chiquita.
Okay.
Great sermon.
Very nice.
Thank you, Florence. Praise God.
You know, and it's a wonder my mother named my brother Jacob.
Yes.
And the church members that know Jacob say, wow, okay.
Yes. Yeah, okay, Tita. Stop telling it all.
My mother, Mrs. Rebus, said,
change that name.
You should change his name.
But Pastor Linda, thank you for letting us know about Jacob, because I didn't know all that about the name Jacob.
You know, I truly hope that we can get to Bible study at some point, but this is what I love about scripture, you know, yes. And that I kind of don't like about the lectionary. There are so many stories that we never hear in worship.
Because
they're not part of our lectionary. And
I think Bible study will be very nice.
Yeah,
I think
Jacob is a good story to hear and remember.
Yeah.
And pray for,
because it tells us that none of us are beyond redemption.
That's right.
Yeah, how about that? Yeah.
Right.
What do you think? After a good wrestling match, no less, right?
Hey, well, so, you know, it's all in the wrestling.
Yeah, that's it.
I really enjoyed your interpretation.
How about that, huh?
Match.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Mother Clendenin.
I had known the story, but your interpretation brings new light to me.
Amen. Amen.
Very good.
Amen. Very good.
You knew Jacob from little. Yes.
All right, family.
Hello,
you guys,
Reggie,
have a good
Taylor.
Day.
I see you there this morning.
Be safe.
Okay.
Be safe. Be safe. Be well. God bless you.
Amen.
Amen. Okay. Everybody be well.
Good week. Why would you?
Okay.
Hey, Mother Shepherd, be well.
Hey, Mother Shepherd, be well.
Love you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much.
You're looking quite beautiful this morning.
Say thank you. She
thank
says
you
look beautiful.
Thank you.
Have a good one. Okay.
You
bye
too.
Bye.
Take
bye
care, Bielka.
Good morning, everybody. Be blessed.
Okay, love
take
you
care,
all.
Take care, Clyde. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Take care, everyone. Have a wonderful week.
You too, everybody.
We'll see you next Sunday.
Yes, everybody be blessed.
Amen.